Hello, my name is Pavel. I'm Pavel Snagovsky. I'm software engineer from Quantum Corporation. And I'm here to talk about using persistent storage in the public cloud. So first we will discuss what the current options are and how they are being used by Kubernetes. And then I will provide an example of using storage orchestrator and local storage of the instances in the public cloud to make your storage more cloud native. Let's put it this way. Then we will look at some examples and questions and answers and conclusions. So we all love and know persistent disks provided by our cloud providers. So they're extremely durable. We use it all the time. It's practically became default way of obtaining persistent storage in public cloud. So they're highly durable. There's a very convenient snapshotting functionality. They're fairly performant. And there's quite a few options to get performance you actually desire. They're elastic at this point on both on Google and AWS, so you can dynamically scale them. They provide encryption. They provide dynamic provisioning, all the good stuff. So, however, there's few things that actually current offerings that are not quite working for cloud-native applications. And those things are the provisioning time of persistent disk or EBS is significant. Persistent disks take a while to provision, so they are not quite instant. And when you fail over, it actually does matter. So your failover times will be significant. Those offerings are expensive, so we all perhaps opening our eyes seeing the EBS charges when we use something more than generic storage. And besides, they have locality limitations, so volumes could be, they're zone specific. Those volumes could be only, they live only in specific zone. In order to move it, you have to do it through the snapshot and recreate the volume. And they're, of course, proprietary. So, however, there's another option there. There's a local storage that I feel is being often overlooked, and people just go with the default using the persistent disk. So what good about local storage? So this is really the instant storage that the disks connected directly to the node that is hosting your VMs. It provides you very low latency, very, very high performance of I/O. It's very, very inexpensive. So disk is cheap, and comparatively speaking, if you're talking about the services for persistent storage that are provided, local storage is inexpensive. It has both options for transactional and streaming I/O. So you would be able to get the spinning disks, you would be able to get SSDs over SCSI or NVMe. And it provides really very consistent performance. So the problem with local storage for the most part is this lack of dynamic provisioning, which is not quite true for Google, but very true for Amazon. And the data durability. So that storage is usually considered to be ephemeral. So if we would be able to, so this claim that I'm making that instant store is faster than EBS could be proved with this graph. So what I did, I took an instance in AWS and I attached two different EBS volumes, one with provisioned I/O and another one just GPT-2. And I use the NVMe disks. And what we're looking at, I/O completion latency in microseconds here, and for 16K blocks. And I tested reads and writes for both sequential and random. If you look at the last four right here, so these are all for the local disk. So your operations or your operations are usually complete within 50 microseconds, as opposed to if you look in any of the network attached storage, the EBS. So your I/O completion practically 10 times of that. So Local storage really does provide very, very high performance at the low cost. The only problem is the durability and lifecycle management. If we would be able to solve those problems, we will get very performant, very awesome storage at very low cost. So yes. I'm working for Rook project. I'm participating to development of Rook project. It's an open source project, and it's orchestrator, storage orchestrator that is fully integrated into Kubernetes, and it utilizes all the Kubernetes functionality to deliver a cloud-native storage experience. So it basically leverages CRDs, it generates a storage class, it's backed by Ceph, it provides fully automated lifecycle management for your storage. So it has all self-healing and monitoring functionality, it gives you a block, file, and object store. Let me demonstrate. Let me do a quick demo. So on the, can we see it? We cannot see my shell. Can you see my shell? Okay. So what I will try, should I make it bigger? Is it better? Okay. So I have a cluster running in Google Cloud. So I'm using the Kubernetes service in Google. So this cluster is a three, has three workers, and I just created it 10 minutes ago, right before this presentation. So it's a bare cluster, there's nothing on it. And I would like to demonstrate how easy it is to install Rook and start creating PVCs that could be consumed by your nodes. So what Rook adds right now, Rook would be able to, out of multiple devices, it would be able to create a storage pool and provide replication. So it will solve the problems that we are trying to solve for the local storage. It will use a local disk, providing this amazing performance. And at the same time, it will provide the durability by replicating your data across multiple nodes. So it solves the problems that really stay in the way of using utilizing local storage at low cost and high performance. So the first thing that needs to do is Rook using operator pattern of management. So it's just a set of external controllers that are watching for events that are meaningful to Rook and take action on it. First thing we need to do, we need to deploy the operator. So operator itself, so let's create operator. So operator itself will put all the containers into Rook name Rook system namespace, and what we will see here is. So what we will see here is we will see operator itself that is running, and we will see we also have a daemon set for Rook agent. So Rook using the flex volume plugin, and we have an agent on each node that is running and really managing the RBD commands and Ceph commands. So at this point we have operator, and what you also would need to install, you would need to define your cluster and install the cluster. So let me install the cluster, and then I will show you the CRD for the cluster and discuss a couple of options. So Rook cluster has a CRD, and you would be able to define what devices you would like to use for your Rook storage pools. So you would be able to put, for example, regex or some sort of criteria by which you would like to select the devices. And you also have a different set of criteria you can insert to specify which nodes you would like to be part of the cluster. So, and once you define the cluster, Rook operator will be looking for any changes for it and will automatically take action. So, providing you this fully automated lifecycle management. In my example here, I'm not doing anything fancy at all. So I'm just using, so you would be able to use raw devices to for your Rook storage, or you would be able to use also a file system. Just a path on the file system is also an option to use. In this case, I'm using just a path on the file system. So at this point, we have the cluster defined that will really set which devices we will use for our storage pool. Next, we would need to create the pool itself and define the storage class for Rook. So the storage class will give us the, so will provide us block devices. Right, so once your storage class is defined, it gives you the same dynamic volume provisioning like other well-known storage classes. So it gives you the same functionality and you can dynamically provision volumes by creating the PVCs and let me create very, very quickly the PVC. So at this point we have fully running Rook cluster. So that it took, what, a couple of minutes? And I was talking more than I was actually doing. So it took literally two commands. So at this point, I will create a PVC. And we will just see how it's bound. And we will return to the presentation. So what is happening here, oh, let me actually show the PVC itself. So PVC is very, very simple. So we're using the Rook block storage class that we just created a second ago with the defined devices to use for the pool. And we define the storage size and a few other options for our PVC itself. So at this point, this PVC is bound, and it could be consumed by any pod. Let's speak about performance. So once we define that local storage is very, very high performance, instance store in terms of AWS, it's very, very high performant. What it really means when you put Rook on top of this local instance stores across multiple instances? You're getting significant increase in performance. In this specific scenario, what I did, I took medium-sized AWS instances. All of them would have some local disk. So that local disk was used to put Rook on top. And I'm comparing, and I was created a test pod, and this pod would have within it one Rook volume and one EBS volume. In this case, it's GP2. And I run the FIO tests against these volumes, just directly on these volumes. And this is the IOPS I'm getting with the 60K block sizes. You can notice that local storage really, really, really give you very nice read performance. Write performance, however, because you need to replicate, write performance is on par about the same like with a persistent disk or with the EBS. Because it have to replicate over the network and you're basically getting similar problems you get with the EBS. You're not talking to your devices over the controller, you're talking to your devices over the network. This is a very different hardware in Google I used. So the numbers are different. However, the performance also significantly higher using the local disk. What also is important to note here, so when you use EBS, typical pattern to use persistent volumes would be to create one EBS volume or persistent disk per pod. And I would like to argue that this is not a good practice if you expect your expect your application to be resilient. For example, it takes a few minutes for the pod that using the EBS volume or persistent disk, it takes a few minutes for it to fail over. Because what needs to happen, you need to do device attach, attach-detach, mount-not-mount. You have to make API calls for provisioning it. The devices themselves would have dependencies on other resources and so forth. So there's a lot of penalties you are getting by using EBS per pod. By using something like Rook, you don't get any of these penalties. So your failover for a pod that uses a persistent volume based off Rook happens practically instantly. There's no penalties whatsoever. You basically have the large storage pool, and you create virtual volumes and delivering it to your pods. And I feel it's significant. So in other comparison that we can make between the EBS or storage, when I speak EBS or say persistent disk, practically everything I'm saying applies to both to Google and Amazon. So let's talk about Zone. Because the each volume is tied to Zone it's in, and we all would like to have resilient Kubernetes clusters that we want to deploy into multiple zones, it makes it gives us a problem if you're using a persistent disk. So when, for example, one zone goes away, so your zone has failed, those pods that had volumes within that zone cannot be rescheduled to a new zone because these volumes are not there. So you can manually, of course, move it, but it will be a significant amount of effort. You can code for it to automate it to some degree, but it's a significant amount of effort. So the problem of running a multi-zone cluster when, by losing a zone, you cannot fail your pods if they use persistent disk, I think it's a significant problem. Significant problem for using, again, this scenario that being recommended of using one volume per pod. Compatibility. So Rook is wonderful not that it takes away the entire management for Ceph from you and everything just magically works, but it's also great as the abstraction layer for your persistent storage within Kubernetes. So if you're using Rook and your PVs, they're really interacting with the Rook storage class. And that creates everything that consumes this, so all your user code wouldn't have to change. You either go to AWS, you go to Google, you go to on-prem, you run it on your laptop. So your code wouldn't have to change. So it's very, very portable. You're really abstracting your storage by one interface with which everything else talks to. So it gives you the portable code. It creates no vendor lock-in. You don't need to know anything about proprietary storage there. It supports multi-environments. You can run your testing anywhere, so it will work the same way on your laptop or in the public cloud or in the private cloud or in the bare metal. And it also avoids the provider-specific functionality. Cost. So this talk is titled that we will be talking about economics. Cost is important here. So I took very small sample here in Google Cloud. And this is a Google Cloud cost calculator. And out of this calculator, what we see, I'm provisioning an instance with the 16 virtual CPUs. And it already has two local disks on it, and yet the size of this disk is 2 disks of 375 gigabit each, and yet the cost of this instance with the local disk still smaller than provisioning a persistent disk. So please note, so this persistent disk is for 300 gigabyte. It costs $16 per day. And the instance with 2 local disks cost less. Isn't it crazy? That's how cheap the local storage is. The similar situation in, even though the local storage is treated differently in Google and Amazon, so like for example in Google, you can dynamically provision local storage to some degree. In Amazon, it's a similar picture. So here's an example of 2 different instances that have all the same compute resources. The only difference between these 2 instance types is availability of the local disk. So one of them doesn't have any local disk attached, and another one has 8 NVMe SSDs. So, and the cost difference here is just 40 cents. So it's if we speak about percentage-wise, so the cost difference between these 2 instances would be on par about 20%. Different instances would provide would have different different cost difference, and there's a lot of things to choose from. So, but this is just one example here. So, in short, the local disk is inexpensive. Very, very, very performant. And it costs significantly cheaper per gigabyte than you would use the block service from your cloud provider. Another good benefit, it's always more efficient to utilize your storage when you're slicing a bigger pool of storage. It would give you way more flexibility to utilize your storage better. And it also will reduce your cost. Once you have more efficient way to utilize your storage, it saves you money. So Rook also could allow you to do a lot of different things. You don't have to use local storage to backup Rook. So you, of course, can use EBS or persistent disk as well. So it's just a block device. So and Rook will take any block device or even path on your file system. So what you could do, you could take, for example, large GP2 EBS, right, and make it to the maximum size to get the maximum amount of IOPS, and then put Rook on top of it and slice it up any way you want, and that could provide you a cost saving. You could use Rook, as I mentioned, provides an object store, and you could use object stores that is internal to your Kubernetes cluster if it fits your tasks, right? Or, so you could theoretically replace S3 and remove it from your bill and use internal to Kubernetes object store. It gives you quite a bit of more flexibility because this is the object store that you manage. So you managing your domains, custom domains, and everything else. Happens absolutely independent from AWS. So if for S3, you would have to move your domains in order to use custom domain, you have to move it to Route 53 and have to use the certificates and everything else. Here you have all the flexibility in the world. Use any domain you like and any user management you like. So it makes it portable as well. So you would be able to run and use this object store in your testing environments, elsewhere, or in your cloud provider. It not only saves you money, it gives you huge portability. And of course, you can create multiple clusters for different workloads. You can create one cluster that is backed by very fast drives, local storage. You can create, and it will serve, for example, your databases. And then you need to store logs somewhere. So you can form another cluster. With the spinning disks underneath it, right? And you would use a different cluster for different type of workload. And if you want to take it even farther and save even more money, Now, since you have reliable, portable, persistent storage, you are able to deploy some services that you currently pay Amazon for. You can deploy it within the cluster now and reliably make them portable and reduce your bill. So if you have a service that, for example, self-healing and self-replicating and everything else, somebody wrote a Helm chart for it, you just deploy this and use it instead of the service. It will save you money. It will make your applications more portable. To conclude, Rook is awesome. And it's not only awesome, but it also would provide you significantly better flexibility and can reduce your overall cost of running your Kubernetes clusters with persistent data. When you need applications to persist data, you will find that it gives you more flexibility at lower cost. And we went over the compatibility, how Rook makes your code portable. We talked about performance. There's a very, very clear performance gain when you're using the local disk. And if you're overcoming the downsides of local disk, namely, it being ephemeral and not dynamically provisioned. So by using Rook on top of it, you're getting both. You're getting the durability and you're getting the dynamic provisioning. Another thing that I didn't mention, but we were talking about the multi-zones again. So if you're using something like persistent disk, you will not be able to fail over your pods if availability zone died where that persistent disk was. So, and it will affect also the provisioning and failover time. So I would recommend against of using persistent disk per pod, meaning that don't use EBS volume per pod. So I feel that your failover times will be in minutes. So you're really creating a setup in which when you need to failover fast, you can't. I want to fail, and I want to fail fast. Very, very fast. And with EBS, it will be literally minutes. And of course, cost. That concludes my talk, and I'm ready for questions.
So what are the different, I guess, failure modes and new sets of tools that somebody was operating, I guess, like Rook, they need to troubleshoot things? Are there like a set of staff tools that you end up needing to troubleshoot?
Excellent question. So let me repeat it so we could see it. And correct me if I'm paraphrasing it poorly. So the question is, right, Rook provides all this wonderful automated management of your life cycle for yourself, for yourself, right? But what happens if it cannot handle something or you want something that really unique and you want to execute a Ceph command? Well, let's do it. So I have a command here, for example, and you have in Rook containers, we're exposing so let me speak first. in Rook, every Rook container deployed by Rook has a Ceph binary that you can talk to if you provide the right configuration to it. And that's exactly what I was trying to demonstrate. And so I changed the namespace here. So let me add the namespace, and I will show you how it actually works, which is an excellent question there. Okay. So this is namespace, I think it's Rook. And yes, I need to go here and add the namespace here. Okay, so sorry, but this is not, it's not intended to be, but I assure you it actually is the way it works. So you are able to. Yes, go ahead.
And like, I guess further from that, does it actually have zone awareness where it will do, assume at least three replicas of any given file? So does it, you know?
No, Rook by itself does not do it. However, you can use Node Affinity or anything else and manage it yourself. So you can do it. Or if you feel it should be something Rook should be doing, Rook is an open source project. Please create an issue. Let's discuss and let's get it in. So it actually differs for provider. Google and Amazon treat local disk very, very differently. So in Google, what they offer you two different interfaces. You can either use SCSI or you can use NVMe. And you can choose between the two, actually. However, the local disk, the way they give, the way they offer it is they all, you can attach it to any instance. So you don't have to pick specific instance like in AWS. You can attach it to any instance, but the sizes of the disk, they're the same. It's 375 gigabyte, and the maximum is 3 terabytes. So you can attach to each node this much disk. With Amazon, it's a completely different scenario. They really expose to you what they have as a hardware. So they have this node that in their data center, and that node has a storage controller and has disk attached, and they literally giving you this disks raw, and they tell you what type of disk it is, and they vary based on the instance. So that example that I had, so that specific instance had 8 NVMe disks, I think close to 2 terabyte each, something like this, so with a total storage, usable storage somewhere like 15 terabyte. So, and different instances would give you different type of disk, even different interface, or different disk sizes. So with Amazon, it's all different. Any other questions? Actually, it's not quite true.
Okay.
So it depends on the amount of replicas you have. So the way, so each disk would have, each storage device that under Ceph, it's really about Ceph. Depending on, it would have to write to multiple OSDs, and those writes would be based on the amount of replicas you desire. So all it needs to do is just match your replicas that you specified. So if you have replicas 3, you're right, you would try to all 3 OSDs at the side.
Whether it's 3 or 2, you know, I just think 3 seems to be an accepted number. I was just wondering, you lose one of the nodes, and that local disk is or whatever, it goes away volatile. And that node comes back up because hopefully, you know, all the scaling group brings up another node. Rook handles the, you know, the rehydration or whatever the term is.
Yes, it does. So like, let me give you a slightly different example here. For example, Rook operator watches for events. If events match in the criteria it has, it also, like for example, I made in a new node, it matches those criteria, it has the same criteria for the node, criteria for the devices, it will automatically add it in. It removes, it will start automatically rebalancing it. If it sees the same blocks elsewhere, it will start rebalancing it back. There's a lot of self-healing functionality embedded in those controllers, set of controllers that really operator, Rook operator. All right, my time is up. Thank you very much. But please go to rook.io. That's where the Rook, there's more information about Rook. And it's on GitHub. It's open source. Participate, use it, and have fun.